Ngicela ukubonga ithuba ngitholile njengamanje ukuthi ngizothula inkulumo yami. Ngibonge kusolwazi bizwagushi ngokuthi asimeme sikwazi singi-PAA ukuthi sizothula inkulumo yethu emkhandleni khona njengamanje. When I arrived in Japan, I didn't realize how easy it was to learn Japan. If you didn't understand anything that I've said, that was Japanese. But for those of you who are linguistically challenged, I will switch to a language I learned in my early adulthood, which is English. And I hope I do a good enough job in presenting myself in that language, which I define as my 10th home language. I've titled this presentation WAC and Africa. The two are interconnected, but what does the future hold? I wish to begin by saying it may be proper, but maybe coincidental, that a South African is delivering this presentation, which is celebrating three decades of WAC's existence. This is certainly so because WAC exists as a result of apartheid in South Africa. And as an African born a good number of years before 1994, I did not read about apartheid, but I lived it. The establishment of WAC was a direct acknowledgement that politics define everything about archaeology. Yet, with 30 years of history, which almost represents my lifetime, it seems that even WAC members do not have a deep appreciation of the role politics in society and of the role of politics in society and to archaeology in particular. This view is informed by comments currently made by those of our colleagues who have commented on the highly important matter to be discussed in another plenary during this Congress. As I said in my own response to the ongoing debate, and I quote, "I fail to understand how, intellectually so, can one make a distinction between politics and everything to do with humanity. Everything in life is political. Access to water, an important resource no one can live without, is not simply based on proximity to the given individual, to a source of water. It can be highly political. I will even argue that decisions on where we conduct our own fieldwork is deeply political. I do not need to undermine the intelligence of those in this email list by giving an example of such. Where we reside at times has nothing to do with our proximity to workplace, but may be politically defined. As a South African of African descent, I know this only too well. Therefore, we cannot stay out of politics. It might be the easiest thing to say that WAC should stay out of politics, but in practice, this is not possible. I thus support the voices that are reminding us of WAC's responsibility," unquote. Beside the negative role of South Africa in the establishment of WAC, the organization has been led by two well-esteemed scholars from the continent. Basi Anda served as a third president of WAC between 1994 until his death in 1997, and Professor Martin Hall from 1999 until 2003. In the recent past, Adebayo Folorunso served as a vice president of WAC. Africa has, therefore, not only played a negative role in the existence of WAC, but a positive one too in terms of its leadership. Deep within WAC's operations has been the presence of indigenous peoples at our congresses and inter-congresses. Two things are critical here. First, the practice of archaeology, even by WAC members, was still deeply entrenched in the old ways of doing things. It is encouraging, however, that such is beginning to change, considering the efforts to decolonize archaeology in Africa and the world over. With special reference to Africa, the publication of Postcolonial Archaeologies in Africa in 2009 and the recent publication in 2016 of the Community Archaeology and Heritage in Africa Decolonizing Practice is testament to the voices that did not necessarily exist in the same way 30 years ago. There is good reason why I'm limiting my focus to these two publications, and it shall become clear as the Congress progresses. Second, we need to celebrate the impact that has been made by indigenous people in archaeology, something WAC has promoted over the years. Surely, our purpose is not simply for indigenous people to grace our congresses for the feel-good factor. However, it should also be about them growing within the archaeology discipline and holding their own. While this has happened in some instances, I would think it is critical that the voices of indigenous peoples in terms of how their professional interpretations have changed archaeology must be recorded. This will further give credence to the significance of indigenous people, so that they are not just in attendance, nor present as second authors, but instead, they are at the core of knowledge production. At this point, I wish to acknowledge the publication of Being and Becoming an Indigenous Archaeologist in 2010. While I consider this platform significant for indigenous voices, the book is more reflective of their pain rather than their role in the production of knowledge. Pain must be healed, and I challenge those interested for a study on the role of indigenous people in transforming the archaeological discipline. Casting my eyes to the future, what should the future directions of world archaeologists be? Production of heritage around the world is the first thing I want to focus on. It is pleasing that a guilty verdict has been secured by the International Criminal Court against Ahmad al-Faqi al-Mahdi, an Islamic radical, for the destruction of Africa's significant heritage at Timbuktu. It is a first, but should certainly not be the last, as there does seem not to be an end to the destruction of heritage sites. Two, community archaeology should continually be promoted as an ideal approach to archaeology. This is an approach that is sensitive to indigenous communities, and rather than seeing them as a nuisance within the research landscape, nor taps overflowing with research information, they can actually be meaningful partners. But as I said earlier, their participation should go beyond that, such that they can be researchers by their own as well. For instance, Iron Age archaeologists in Southern Africa tell me and others that cattle are the most significant animals, mainly because they are found in the center of the household, highlighting their significance. Is this not a Eurocentric view that is informed by special thinking in the West, where squares are seen as central meeting points where important matters may be discussed? Thus, how do we, as members of WAC and PAA conducting research in Africa, challenge such views and begin to highlight that other animals carry a much higher significance than cattle in African worldview, but they may not easily be found in the archaeological record? In my hand here, I've got a skin of an animal, which is not definitely a cow. It signifies the significance of other animals that archaeologists don't find in archaeological record, and therefore do not give them the significance that they deserve. Three, the re-examination of archaeological terminology. For instance, what do we mean by human remains? Do we speak to the remainders of our ancestors when we visit their graves to pay our respect and ask for the assistance of whatever kind? Four, there is a need to transform heritage legislation in Africa so that the colonial overtones are finally dealt with. It cannot be that during a time when some African countries are celebrating over 50 years of colonial independence, the thinking in heritage legislation is still deeply embedded in the colonial times that, I will argue, fossilizes heritage. There is a good reason why traditional management systems have to be reconsidered in some cases. Fifth, on giving the past a future. I will caution against the tendency to gain community support through our ideas that heritage serves. And just like in Europe and elsewhere, heritage sites we know so much about can be opened for tourism to benefit people. While there are some cases that can attract a number of people in Africa, these, I will argue, are very much in the minority. Lastly, I further do not wish to see WAC continuously becoming an organization that always signs petitions against perceived destruction of cultural heritage without addressing the context of each and every situation. I'm afraid that such uncritical approach to these petitions will simply present us as yet another toothless organization that indirectly relates to the continuation of poverty amongst the indigenous communities. I'm thus looking forward to what declarations are put forward for formal ratification at the end of WAC 8 Congress. Let transformation not be defined by who attends WAC and PAA Congresses, but be based on the basis of who is producing knowledge about the past. In conclusion, it is only proper to acknowledge how the African continent has benefited from the programs of WAC. For instance, through the Global Libraries Program, museums, NGOs, and universities from Kenya, Malawi, Namibia, Nigeria, Senegal, South Africa, and Zimbabwe have benefited immensely. Africa has also benefited through the Archaeology Without Borders program. Therefore, the role of WAC in Africa is clear for all to appreciate, and such efforts should not dissipate. I thus invite Africans to continue supporting WAC in every way possible. PAA offers its support to WAC in our collective efforts to study the past, appreciate it in the present, and present a framework on which the future may hold. I must conclude by saying this presentation is given with the full support of the current PAA president, which is not me, but it's Professor Ibrahima Tiao, who is based at the Archaeology Department at the Cheikh Anta Diop University in Dakar, whom I'm representing at this significant forum. Compatriots, as my South African president will say, I thank you for your attention.